You never know.
I'm glad to be able to stand before you tonight for my first affirmative before we get into the definition and the explaining of the proposition. Again, I want to thank the congregation here last night. We had a delightful singing. It really was good. So I appreciate that. The songs were very respectful for our views, and we could wholeheartedly sing. So we appreciate that so much. I want to thank my moderator, Brent Bischel, coming all the way from Springville, California, to be with me. Usually Steve Bazin is with me, but he owns a business, and since the COVID-19 issue has taken hold, the entire nation, he didn't receive a paycheck for about 5 or 6 weeks, and all of those individuals that work for him were shut down, and he works at his job overnight 7 p.m. to 7 a.m., and it became impossible for him to come. So I demanded Brent Bischel to be here, and he came from Springville, California. I want to thank him. I want to thank Brother Bruce for the discussion thus far, and I want to thank everyone for your good interest. So let's get to the proposition, shall we? The scriptures teach that Jesus of Nazareth returned for the second and final time of the destruction of Jerusalem, AD 70. And in fact, I believe that with all my heart. And when I say the scriptures, of course, we generally go through formalities talking about the entirety of the Bible. You see, I believe that the Bible teaches one great narrative and one great end. And the time of the end is not the end of time. And I believe when the Old Testament saints looked forward to a time of salvation, it would come in unequaled and unparalleled persecution, in which the entirety of the creation would go through a birth pang motif, which in fact is found in Romans chapter 8. And so as the entirety of the world, the creation, not the rocks and the trees and the birds and the bees of Romans 8:21, but they were looking forward for a new reality. And I believe that took place in the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem in AD 70, which became such a significant event to the early church that they pointed to the fact that Jesus predicted the temple would be destroyed and not one stone would be left upon it. It was such an instrument of apologetics for the early church that there was a man by the name of Julian the Apostate who attempted to rebuild the temple, and he was foiled in his attempt. Now let me get to the questions that Brother Bruce has given me tonight. The first question is 1 Corinthians 15:4, a direct quote from Hosea 6 and verse 2. It is a direct allusion and a direct reference to that text, and this is why. It is the only text in the Old Testament where there is a three-day resurrection predicted. If it is not Hosea 6 and verse 2 that Paul is quoting from in 1 Corinthians 15 verse 4, I would ask Brother Bruce to produce the passage. Please produce it for me. He's quoting from the Old Testament. The New Testament was being revealed. The first letter wasn't written until about 51 AD. He cannot quote from a codified whole unless he is quoting from the Old Testament. He has no reference to New Testament scripture there. They were being revealed. He is arguing against the Judaizers, and he is making an argument that will refute their false doctrine. What happens to the wicked who die today? Well, I had the traditional view for many years, as Brother Bruce does, and yet I began to study the book of Isaiah, and I began to look at some of the Hebrew figures like Isaiah 33, where he said the inhabitant would no longer say that he is sick in verse 17. I said, oh, how in that does that work? How is it the case that this death is going to be done away? How is the case it's going to be turning a woman with child and pain and cries out to her? I began to consider this is the language of the prophets. Well, I remember going through Isaiah chapter 10 and verse 18. And so I find verse 17 and 18, so the light of Israel will be for a fire and his Holy One for a flame. It will burn and devour his thorns and briars in one day. Same language, by the way, is used in Hebrews chapter 6, verses 6 and 8. He's going to burn up the thorns and the thistle. Same thing, all right? And I'm pretty sure the book of Hebrews is written to a Jewish audience. Now the Bible says in verse 18, it will consume the glory of his forest, of his fruitful field, both soul and body. You see, the concept of a body and a collective idea was not a new idea in New Testament days. Jesus would speak collectively about the body in Matthew 10 and verse 28. It is my view that Jesus meant exactly the same thing as Isaiah did. He would consume this body. Now notice what he says in verse 18, and they will be as a sick man waste away. Then the rest of the trees of his forest will be so few in number that a child may write them. You see, that's national judgment language. In Isaiah chapter 10 and verse 4, we find verse 5, woe to Assyria, the rod of my anger. So the northern tribes are going to be consumed. It is the language of the prophets to say body and soul consumed in the time of judgment. And again, the Bible speaks about the time of the end, not an end of time. So whatever Isaiah 10:18 meant is what Jesus meant, because he's a Jewish prophet. I'm pretty sure he's not combating Jewish, Gentile false doctrine in Matthew chapter 10. In Matthew 10, Jesus said in verse 23, when they persecute you in this city, go to another. You shall not gone over the cities of Israel till the Son of Man be come. He's talking about his second coming here. Because it's a time of persecution. That's not Pentecost, because there was favor with God with all the people in Acts 2:47. We're talking about a time of intense persecution. And so Jesus is going to rescue some of them. Not all of them would die. Some of them would be there at his kingdom, and that's what he means. What is the body that saves? Of course, it's the church that saves. That's my position. My position is that the Bible and the New Testament sets forth the transitioning of the covenants from one kind of body to another kind of body, from one kind of kingdom to another kind of kingdom, to one kind of system, natural and fleshly, into a kingdom. And so there's a process that takes place. That's exactly what Paul affirmed in Philippians 3, verse 16, to the degree that I have attained. Now, what's he talking about in that chapter? Resurrection, a process. Bruce said something the other night. Well, there's a difference between a prolepsis and incremental revelation. In all due respect, he hasn't seen the implications of his position. In Romans chapter 4 and verse 17, the Bible says about Abraham that in fact he is calling him the father of many nations. And so he calls things that do exist as though they did not. Now, here's the question. Did Abraham become the father of nations through a process? Or was it a miraculous transformation? No, through the process. But it's a prolepsis. I have given you the city. Now how is the city gotten? They had to go around the city six times, right? And then on the seventh day, the trumpets blow, the walls came down from Jericho. That is a prolepsis and incremental revelation. And so, Brother Bruce, I disagree with your conclusions. I don't think that that is correct at all. If spiritual death was abolished in AD 70, how can a Christian die spiritually today through rebellion? Through a rebellion. That's exactly what Revelation chapter 21 says. Now, I believe this is a picture of the fulfillment of the church. I don't believe that this is heaven at all. It was at hand at the time that John was writing. So, as he speaks about this new relationship with God above and new relationship with man beneath, once the law ends, and it didn't end at the cross, but by means of the cross, that's my position. Verse 24 says, and the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light. All right? So if that's heaven, then the condition is you must walk in its light. Well, what did Jesus say in 1 John 1:7? Right? As we walk in the light,